You're listening to the audio production of The Wondering Years, How Pop Culture Helped Me Understand Life's Biggest Questions by Knox McCoy, published by Thomas Nelson and read by the author.
For Roe, Sidigrei, and Marlowe, in all the fictional worlds I visited, the one I share here with you is my most favorite. On introductions. I gotta say, as a society, we've really lost our way when it comes to introductions. It's all lead-bearing in the transfer of non-essential information. A typical introduction goes something like, "Hello, I'm Dwayne. I work in IT. Think about that. What do we know about Dwayne now? Basically, his name and his job? Two things that 92% of Americans report being dissatisfied with. That's actually not a real stat, but it feels like a real stat, doesn't it? And I'm going to admit something to you that I have no idea what IT even means. Something about technology, or computers probably? Intrepid Technologer? Illuminati Task Force? I don't know. Sure, I could Google it and find out, but that would take effort. And I just don't care that much, which is the essence of modern-day introductions. No one cares that much. You know who does introductions right? People on Game of Thrones. Specifically the show's central figure, Daenerys Targaryen. Listen to the impression she makes with her title. Daenerys Stormborn of the House Targaryen, first of her name, the Unburnt, Queen of the Andals and the First Men, Khaleesi of the Great Grass Sea, Breaker of Chains, and Mother of Dragons. That is such a satisfying introduction, it should probably come with a cigarette. We get a lot of stuff we can figure out. Example, she probably can't be burnt, I'm assuming, as well as some stuff we need more info on. So, Daenerys, tell me more about these dragons, you mother. What's their thing? Like, what are they about? Bottom line, it's a great introduction because it entertains, informs, and gives tons of material regarding who she is and what she's about. Quite a bit better than Dwayne from IT, right? Let's look at another great introduction, the theme song of The Fresh Prince of Bel-Air. It is sonically pleasing, and it provides the foundational context of the show. In the span of a couple minutes, we get the following info. Will grew up and came to physical maturity in West Philadelphia. There, he was often found spending his days on the playground. This was the setting for one skirmish with such ominous forebodings that his mother feared for Will's safety. Therefore, she put him in a taxi cab and sent him from Philadelphia to Bel-Air. Does it matter that the cab ride would have meant Will rode approximately 2,750 miles? It's called suspension of disbelief, you guys. That's an entire origin story delivered concisely, delightfully, and expertly by the lead character. It only makes sense that you'd want to watch the episode to follow. One last example of introductions done well, The Lion King. As far as I'm concerned, it's the piece de resistance of introductions. We're introduced to the setting of Pride Rock with a broad lyrical rumination of how we are all very much connected through an Elton John song, which, I think we can all agree, is the most obvious vehicle for rumination like that. And the central message of this lyrical sequence is thematically crucial. It's important that the viewer buy into this idea of connection and how circular the circle of life is, because all the animals in the movie already fully embrace the idea. As the movie begins, we're introduced to all the animals traveling to Pride Rock, where their Lion King, Mufasa, lives with his royal family. Everyone is really feeling the celebratory vibe, and Rafiki, the shaman monkey character, walks through the crowd and bear hugs, monkey hugs, Mufasa, like they are BFFs, despite probably not being naturally simpatico in the wild. I can't authoritatively say that monkeys and lions are adversaries in the wild, but if I had to guess, I would say that they probably aren't allies, final answer Regis. But because of Elton's song, we remember the circle of life thing, so it's fine, we go with it. Next, we realize the animals are celebrating the birth of Mufasa's son, Simba, the future king of Pride Rock. Here's where things get crazy. Rafiki presents Simba to the gathered animals and they lose it. These animals are for real acting like Oprah just gave them a car or something. The monkeys act like they freebase illegal stimulants, the antelopes are going bonkers supreme, and the giraffes literally cannot even with all this lion cub cuteness. These animals are handling this situation like white people would handle a 75% off sale at Pottery Barn. I say would handle because Pottery Barn actually never offers any kind of significant discount. They just make you stare down the reality that, like it or not, you will pay $129 for a table runner, and there's nothing you can do about it. We can all agree that this atmosphere is a little incredible, right? Rafiki is honoring the apex predator that feeds on these animals, Mufasa, by presenting the next apex predator legacy monster, Simba, who will not only feed on some of these very animals that are present, but also probably the children and grandchildren of those animals. Imagine knowing that your current boss's son, no matter what, will eventually lord over you just because of the circle of employment. Could you conjure up that kind of enthusiasm for your boss's son? I'm telling you right now that I super could not. Anyway, the best part of this opening sequence is that, straight out of the gate, we get a sense of the royal hierarchy, the central players, and the primary character, Simba. Rafiki literally holds him up as a light shines on him. Wouldn't life be better if all stories followed this template? You wouldn't have to trouble yourself with whether or not Dwayne from IT is someone you should spend time getting to know. My point is, the best introductions tell you what is up concisely and creatively. You get a little bit of information with a side of entertainment. And truthfully, I just want a proper introduction and context on who I'm spending time with. Ever notice how some books jump right into things like we've been dropped into a noir crime novel? Gut shot and panicked, I arrived at the destination of my emotional abyss. An opening line like this and I'm like, who's the gut shot person? And what abyss destination have we arrived at? Is it a Chuck E. Cheese or like a metaphorical Chuck E. Cheese? Maybe I'm a simple man with simple desires, but I like to get to know someone before arriving at the destination of our emotional abysses together. You know what I mean? For example, if we were meeting, I'd want to communicate the following in an effort to make a connection with you. I am Knox, December-born of the House McCoy, first of his name, probably, easily burnt on beaches, king of the grill and the barbecue smoker, and allergic to grass, cats, and shellfish, breaker of small talk and social engagements at the last minute, if at all possible, and father of poorly conceived yet ambitious metaphors. And now that we have that connection, you should probably also know that everything I know about life, I learned in some part from The Wonder Years. The theme song, Joe Cocker's cover of With a Little Help from My Friends, taught me the need for community. The use of adult Kevin as younger Kevin's narrator made me aware that there might be an omniscient presence observing my life too. Definitely God, but sometimes Santa too, and they probably compared notes. And remember how for a hot minute, everyone thought Josh Saviano, the actor who played Kevin's best friend Paul, grew up to be Marilyn Manson? That made me confront a reality in which the world of popular culture could fold neatly into the realm of spirituality and potential principalities of darkness. As a kid, I spent a lot of time caught up in my own thoughts and chasing them around inside my head. I spent time parsing silly things like why Donkey Kong was called a donkey when he was really a giant ape, or how on earth Kevin Arnold could snag Winnie Cooper. But I also tried deconstructing deeper questions like who God was and what it was that he wanted from me. It was often pop culture that helped me fill in the gaps of my understanding, sometimes in hilarious ways, and sometimes in ways that were accidentally profound. And that's what this book is about, how I navigated life in the time I call the Wondering Years. Chapter 1, The First Time I Was Punched in the Face. The first time I got punched in the face was when I was 10 years old, and it was by this real jerk face named Daniel. I don't know if that's the median age for face punching among white American kids, but that's when my number came up. Up to this point, my only experience with punching came from Mike Tyson's Punch-Out on Nintendo and action movies, most notably the Rocky movies. Fun fact, I never made it past Piston Honda, as the directness of the conflict via my Nintendo gave me too much anxiety. This foreshadowed my future fighting abilities. You may not be familiar with Sylvester Stallone's Rocky franchise. In a nutshell, Rocky Balboa was a boxer from Philly who could definitely throw a punch. But his thing was that he could take a punch, multiple punches, all the punches, even. In the first movie, Rocky fought the heavyweight world champ, Apollo Creed, to a split decision simply because he was preeminently punchable. Like Johnny Depp gained strength from playing weird characters, or Taylor Swift grows more powerful from relationship complications, so too did Rocky gain strength from getting punched. As such, I assumed this would be the same for me. To be completely honest, I should have seen it coming. Daniel and I went to school together, though we were never in the same class. He had been held back a year in school, as is often the way with bullies. You know, just once I'd love to see a precocious kid who skipped a grade or two be the chief antagonist of a much older and more physically mature kid. Not that I advocate kid-on-kid violence, but it would be a change of pace, you know. Imagine any of the kids from Stranger Things bullying someone like Biff Tannen from Back to the Future. You can't pretend you're not at least a little interested in that movie. Our rivalry was essentially about athletics, and this came into full focus on field day, which is basically elementary school Olympics. Anyway, on a random day in the fall, I was hanging out at my best friend Blake's house, and Daniel, who lived nearby, came over. This wasn't out of the ordinary. I was often over at Blake's house, and I regularly crossed paths with Daniel. Despite a healthy subtext of dislike between the two of us, Daniel and I still played together because, frankly, it would have been weird not to. I'm convinced this is where kids and adults diverge. If kids don't like each other, they just deal with it because they don't have any recourse, and the world isn't that big yet. For adults, though, the sky's the limit. You can turn mutual friends against that person, subtweet them via social media, or ignore them in the detergent aisle at Publix. But kids, man, they just deal. So Blake and I were tossing around a football, and Daniel wanted in. We obliged because why not? After all, if a tentative, unspoken peace can't be brokered over football, haven't the terrorists already won? Before I knew it, we were blissfully tossing the old pigskin around, just three red-blooded boys engaged in a highly chill game of catch. Except soon, Daniel threw a variable into the mix by catching the ball from Blake, but not throwing it to me. Exterior, Blake's backyard. Blake and Knox exchange looks as if to say, "What's this guy's deal?" Daniel throws the football in the air to himself like a cat passive-aggressively playing with another cat's toy and begging for a confrontation. Knox takes the bait. "Hey, Daniel, super quick question. How about we keep this highly chill game of catch going and you resume tossing me the football?" Daniel, thoughtful pause. "No, I don't think so." Blake and Knox exchange another look as if to say, "Can you believe this guy's deal right now?" Knox walks over to Daniel. "Dude, come on, throw it to me or give it back to me so we can throw the ball." Daniel thoughtfully considers these options as if he's a CPA considering property depreciation. "No, I don't think I want to do either of those things." Knox, "Okay then, here's the deal." And right then, Daniel punched me in the nose, which is the second most annoying place to get punched. By the way, the fourth most annoying place to get punched is the stomach because you can't breathe or talk. The third is the ear because it disorients you. And the first, for dudes, is in the below-the-belt biscuits region for very obvious reasons. I think we all understand that. The nose is particularly annoying, though, because it bleeds and your eyes water. So not only is there bloody evidence of you getting a beatdown, but it also looks like you've been brought to tears. It's the equivalent to getting a wedgie on your face. The attack itself is less painful than the humiliation. To sum up, blood gushed out of my nose, Daniel ran off with our ball, our highly chill game of catch was over, and I realized I didn't take punches like Rocky took punches. In retrospect, I can say that this was the first significant conflict of my life, which I know makes me an incredibly privileged person. I accept that characterization with no protest. Part of this delayed trauma is because I come from a privileged home situation and background, but also because, in terms of personality type, I was a pretty low-key kid. I eagerly avoided conflict and reprimand. Even now, I get stressed about something as dumb as walking into Target through the exit door because I assume a red shirt is going to swoop in and reprimand me for it. In reality, though, I know that, in my experience, most red shirts at Target wouldn't even intervene if I was performing an animal sacrifice in the greeting card aisle. Regardless, my default is to simply avoid conflict. The exception has always been sports. In the arena of athletic contests, I transformed into a Tasmanian devil of jerkiness. You take someone who is hyper-competitive, petty, and sensitive, and then add a healthy dose of the male ego, and boy, oh boy, do you have a potent gumbo of emotional instability on your hands. But outside of sports, I was very reserved, and I remain so to this day. And to be honest, I don't mind this aspect of myself, but not so much after experiencing my first face punch. I was stunned with the knowledge that a punch-taking Rocky Balboa I was not, but even more affecting was my response, or lack thereof. Daniel just walking away with my football and face-punching virginity and me taking no recourse was just not the narrative I had anticipated for myself. I'd assumed I'd be like, if not Rocky, maybe Arnold Schwarzenegger from the Terminator movies. I would have expected to handle the situation with Daniel like this. Exterior, dark alley, nighttime. There I am, shirtless, ripped, and wearing sunglasses despite it being night. Around me, trash cans billow with fire. Daniel refuses to throw me the football, so I activate my Terminator eye and confront him. He tries to sass me, then lands a punch, but it doesn't even hurt despite drawing a little blood. I slowly wipe the blood from my nose with the back of my hand and say something awesome that sounds part hiss, part threat, and part Voltaire. Knox, no one makes me bleed my own blood. Before counterpunching Daniel into infinity and retrieving the football as he flies into an endless vortex of regret for having ever stepped to me. But I did none of these things. There was no infinity punching, and there weren't even trash cans billowing with fire, because that would have been so against the HOA of Blake's neighborhood. As you can tell, getting punched in the face was a formative experience for me, as is getting hit with the revelation that expectation isn't reality. My expectation of how I would react to conflict had been influenced by pop culture, and as I would find out, life didn't always go down like that. Even at age 10, many aspects of my life, including my faith, showed the influence of pop culture. My first visualized manifestation of God was George Burns. Somehow, around age 6, I came into contact with his performance as God in Oh God, and I internalized it. Why? I have no idea. But it stuck. He's still my default avatar for God to this day. I can only imagine that by this same logic, there are generations of kids who, when they think about God, might visualize Morgan Freeman from Bruce Almighty or the disembodied face from Monty Python. If this is true, I'm very jealous of these kids, specifically the Morgan Freeman as God kids. My vision of God is a guy who is like a million years old and looks like he smells like the Great Depression. Their vision is the guy who narrated March of the Penguins and who helps Bruce Wayne gear up for awesome Batman missions. Well, I mean, I think we're actually even now because given the Me Too...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.